Dear viewers, welcome to this show Power Chat, Nepal's only TV talk show in English discussing development since 2016. Through this episode tonight, we are discussing humanitarian work during crisis, focusing on the agenda of reforms for Nepal Red Cross Society. I'm joined tonight by Mr. Pitambar Ariyar, Secretary General of Nepal Red Cross Society, country's largest humanitarian organization. Let's talk. Welcome to the show, Mr. Ariyar.
Thank you very much for inviting me in this important kind of program.
Well, you have been into the humanitarian work for a long time and recently working with the Nepal Red Cross Society, country's largest humanitarian organization, as I mentioned at the beginning. Nepal Red Cross Society in Nepal have long been criticized for not maintaining transparency. Also, there were media reports about the good governance issues. So you are new with the Nepal Red Cross Society as the General Secretary, along with other members and leaders. How do you evaluate the current state of humanitarian work in relation to delivery of Nepal Red Cross Society throughout all these years?
Well, when it comes to my involvement with Red Cross Society, definitely I am new for this position as Secretary General. However, I had been, or I used to be involved in a various roles and responsibilities. I started my volunteer career at the school, like being junior and youth Red Cross member and teacher sponsor. And later on, I used to be professional, or I was heading health service department, disaster management department, and youth Red Cross department of Nepal Red Cross Society. That was, I think, more than 15 years my involvement. And at the same time, I used to be with the IFRC, and being a member of IFRC, I know Nepal Red Cross and its working kind of procedures or modalities. Definitely last 8 or 9 years, let's say not that, maybe around 5-6 years, I was completely out from Nepal Red Cross Society. I used to be with IFRC. That's why, of course, I have been seeing or observing various news and various media kind of reports and various concerns as well. And it is highly essential to ventilate to our audience or public what Nepal Red Cross has been doing or where we can move forward. And basically, when it comes to various allegations or controversies that has been investigated by various authorities, they are the competent authorities, and at the same time, current ad hoc committee also form kind of task forces in order to review and see what were the recommendations been made by various task forces, and at the same time, how we can really identify those gaps or errors been made in the past. So based on that, we have been working very, very rigorously to come up with a clear kind of agenda for transformation of Nepal Red Cross Society. And when it comes to your question regarding humanitarian services or work, Nepal Red Cross has been involved or conducting its services, humanitarian services, since its establishment. But when it comes to our tenure, or when we started our kind of responsibility, basically COVID-19 has imposed unprecedented challenges to humanitarian world, and it has created a great problem or severe problem in terms of gathering or sharing or maintaining physical contacts. So it has a huge impact. Besides the fact, Nepal Red Cross has been mobilizing its volunteers as well as its staff to respond to COVID pandemic.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Ariyar, for this observation. I will come back to you on your way of work here in Nepal amid COVID-19 pandemic. But again, do you agree that the resources have been misused in the recent years with the Red Cross? Because there are not only media reports, but also criticism from the oversight bodies as well? And what are your plan, you know, putting the Red Cross glorious history in Nepal at place?
Well, we would like to, while saying we, it means the ad hoc committee is committed to make its services very efficient or cost effective. That is our first kind of commitment that was been made during our first CC meeting. And secondly, we want to maintain transparency. All the work being carried out by ad hoc committee will be very, very transparent. And we want to ensure or adhere or comply good governance mechanisms. So these are our key principles. Of course, we are guided by Nepal Red Cross, our Red Cross principles, international Red Cross principles, which really or which clearly indicates that all these principles come there as well. Like, you know, humanity, impartiality, or neutrality, or there are independence, there are seven basic principles, which also talks about transparency or following the minimum humanitarian principles as well. So we are very much committed. And secondly, as I highlighted in my earlier conversation or saying that we really want to see those recommendations made by various investigation committees formed by Social Welfare Council or formed by even within Red Cross, Nepal Red Cross had formed a committee, and there was some sort of investigation going on in the past as well, and district administration office. So we would like to go through, and we have already gone through those recommendations, and certain actions have been taken as already. So while saying that definitely we need to improve our system, and when it comes to proper use of resources, that is a key concern. And whenever we get a huge resource from international support or generate funding domestically, we need to make sure that that resource goes to targeted population.
Well, what is your vision of the Red Cross? I mean, the new leadership's vision of Red Cross here in Nepal, the principles that you are mentioning, that of the neutrality, transparency, objectivity and all.
Well, we would like to be very, very transparent and accountable, cost-effective humanitarian agency which could deliver humanitarian services to most vulnerable population. Or the way we work will help to reduce humanitarian or human suffering. It means that we would like to mobilize the our volunteer kind of power as well as staff or kind of humanitarian power to alleviate human suffering. That is our prime vision. But when I say this one, there are some elements which really need to go through. Like while delivering humanitarian services, of course you can reach to 100 people, but how much resource has been spent to reach to those population? Whether this agency reached to the most needed population or still vulnerable populations or beneficiaries or target population are left out, that is very important. So we want to make sure that all the humanitarian principles are followed so that needy populations receive our services, either through our headquarters or branches or provincial branches or local branches. Local means we have a sub-chapter and junior youth committees. So we would like to optimize our volunteer capacity or nationwide network to reach to most vulnerable population.
Well, Mr. Arial, how do you summarize your work amid the current state of COVID-19? How are you reaching out to the most vulnerable groups, and how are you partnering with the other stakeholders, minimizing the impact of current state of pandemic?
Actually, Nepal Red Cross Society, as you rightly highlighted, that one of the largest humanitarian organization in Nepal. It has 77 district chapters. We have 7 provincial committees, but it has many sub chapters and a huge network of junior youth Red Cross circle. So there are more than 100,000 trained volunteers, and we have 1 million general members, or total it's more than a million kind of volunteers. So it's a very, very big network. That's why reaching to most vulnerable becomes little bit easier compared to other agencies. When we start any program, we headquarter doesn't directly implement to the area or targeted area. We go through our province and district chapter and sub chapter. That's why we have some sort of comparative advantage to mobilize our volunteers or trained human resources. When it comes to COVID response, from the very beginning, we started COVID response, or Nepal Red Cross had started COVID response in February. Although even government of Nepal, imposed or started the lockdown in March. So Nepal Red Cross, with the support of International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies, started working on COVID-19 response. That was started with having some sort of guideline, some kind of approach paper, how to reach or how to deliver information or services to most vulnerable. That was the key work. And once approach paper was designed, then later on safety and security guideline was been developed. And Nepal Red Cross has been providing services to through its ambulance services or blood transfusion services and first aid services. There are many frontline health workers or frontline workers. So we wanted to make sure that they are safe, but at the same time they are able to continue or deliver services. That's why we started upgrading our ambulances. Most of our ambulances were grade C, but we had to upgrade them to grade B or grade 2 in order to ensure that there is no transmission, but at the same time they are safe and deliver services or transport the patient without any fear. For that, we provided support to district chapters to upgrade ambulances having compartment, or providing mask or sanitizer and all the PPEs, particularly for drivers. We had to provide full gown PPEs as well, so that at least they are safe, but at the same time they won't be source of infection for patient as well. So there is a both possibility, getting infected from the patient or transmitting a virus from the driver. It could happen. That's why we had to work on that, and we did that. And secondly, we have many blood transfusion centers, and blood is a lifeline service which needs to be continued, either it is during emergency or non-emergency situation. But during pandemic, it has due to low level of volunteer donor program or limited volunteers donating blood, we had huge difficulties to maintain that as well. And our blood transfusion service worker, they were highly exposed or highly vulnerable. That's why we provided all kind of safety and security materials or supplies to them, and at the same time our first aid worker as well. That was our first priority to really continue our lifeline services. And secondly, that was not enough, because there was a high possibility of at that time community transmission, although it was not happening. Then government was our government and local bodies or local government started having quarantine centers or holding centers. So we provided our services or support to quarantine and holding centers by providing hygiene kits or blankets, tarpaulins, buckets, and even we established hand washing posts. So in this way we provided our support to government. And later part, what we did was we had a collaboration with the International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies. We have various partners, PNSS, as well as like UNICEF or WHO, UN agencies, and even Coca-Cola Foundation. And they provided many items like ventilators. And we are handing over ventilators in 7 hospitals. And we started from Kathmandu, and we went to Province 1 and Province 2, and Province 3, I think most probably today they are handing over, and we are going to Province 5. In this way, 3 also done. So all 7 provinces, mostly the government identified specialized hospitals who provide, COVID response or treatment services, we are handing over ventilators. Not only that, other PPEs and other items also handed over to government treatment centers in a phased manner. So I would like to highlight here, it's not only hardware part, but we also worked in software part, like organizing training, IPC, infection control and infection prevention and control. That is basically for drivers and frontline workers, as well as our volunteers. Because volunteers, they are working rigorously in the community or in the districts. That's why we use virtual means in order to organize this kind of trainings. While doing so, we invited technical people from government of Ministry of Health as well, in order to facilitate some trainings as well.
Well, Mr. Arial, you touched upon so many interesting issues. Really exciting to know that you are working with the vulnerable communities here in Nepal, minimizing the impact of COVID-19. Any specific reference or studies or, your engagement protecting the most vulnerable groups, including that of the children and women?
Of course, I wanted to highlight that part as well. While saying or while delivering services, we didn't only focus on hardware or software. At the same time, we provided services to street children, like combo kit, like food combo kit kind of package was being distributed to our street children. And at the same time, Kishori kit or dignity kits have been distributed to those people. And you rightly highlighted that mostly elderly or people with disability or women or children, they are most vulnerable, and many cases they are subject to exploitation or abuse as well. That's why we have been focusing on that matter. And within Nepal Red Cross we have 13 departments. Out of them, one is working for protection, gender and inclusion. We call it PGI or JC. So whatever we call, but prime focus of this department is to identify needs of those marginalized groups and design program and implement accordingly. And some cases it implements vertically to the community, but at the same time that department ensures that other departments are using a PGI lens while identifying needs of the community, while working for DRR or DRM, disaster risk reduction or disaster risk management or community resilience program or health service program. They need to ensure that protection, gender or inclusion elements are included, or those lens are there. For that, they develop some sort of guideline and some kind of checklist and even monitoring checklist as well. And that ensures that all the departments are using those lens, and whether they certify or not. That kind of mechanism also we are working.
Also, could you elaborate more about the disaster preparedness here in Nepal, a part of the humanitarian work? And the recent report published about the disaster condition, the states about the geographic impact in the countries like Nepal. Are stakeholders in Nepal, including that of the state authorities, ready to tackle with any possible disaster?
Well, thanks for raising this issue. And this has been a key challenge for Nepal as well as many other developing countries, including developed as well. And we know climate change impact has greatly contributed to have very, very, extreme events, either that is flood or landslides or, heat wave or cold wave or many kind of like cyclones, and many people killed due to disaster events. And when you see disaster occurrences, then of course mostly coping capacity of developing country is very, very less compared to developed countries, because they have a system and forecasting mechanisms are there, and good technology has been properly used. But in our case, basically, I wouldn't say government is not working. Definitely government has done quite good preparation and work. But however, when we compare with disaster incidents and our response mechanism, still it is not very, very adequate. That's why there is a huge need to improve or strengthen our capacity. Either it is government capacity or other agencies' capacity. I mean, we worked quite a lot in order to establish a national disaster risk reduction and management authority. And there is an act. Before we didn't have, we had a natural disaster relief act. But now the act has been changed and it is more encompassing all the elements or components of disaster risk reduction or preparedness, which is very, very holistic. And there is a council, and you know, a council is chaired by Prime Minister, and there is a executive committee as well. So various agencies are member of that. But while saying that, probably COVID response has been done through other act, since we have already DRRM Act, then probably this could have been activated rather using other act and forming other mechanisms. But government felt that that is the best option. That's but what I would like to highlight here is that still a holistic approach is needed. Now COVID is not a only health problem or health issue. It is social, economic, and even psychological. And there are so many impact of COVID, you know, infection. It's not only a person is becoming sick, but whole system is going to be collapsed because no economic opportunities are moving, or migrant workers are returning. And, you know, basically unemployment problem is there, and people are not really engaged in construction sector or other areas. Now, gradually it is reviving, so it has a huge impact to our economy as well. That's why disaster, during this pandemic situation, disaster risk and its impact is very, very high, because response mechanism is not functioning. Like, we face same problem, how to respond to flood victims or let's say affected population or landslide affected population. Then we have to maintain safety and security as well. So this has created our weaken or I would say weaken system, already weaken system.
Well, Mr. Arial, there are so many interesting issues you are sharing with us, but we are coming to the end of the show. You said that, you know, you reiterated actually that Nepal Red Cross Society is the largest humanitarian organization here in Nepal with network in all districts, but at the same time you you know, also agreed that your resources have not been properly utilized responding to the crisis, especially that of the, you know, lack of blood or those who in need of emergency work. What should be done so that, you know, during the time of emergencies and during the time of crisis, most vulnerable groups and needy peoples are easily accessed to these services very quickly?
Thank you for this question. I think probably I need to little bit clarify that Nepal Red Cross, to be very honest, doesn't get financial support from government. Only for certain areas like blood transfusion or certain places, it gets some sort of support, except policy support. Nepal Red Cross doesn't get financial kind of contribution from government. Besides that, Red Cross is able to generate funding from international partners. So we would like to build a good relation with our government counterparts or authorities so that there is a smooth kind of flow of resources from international. But at the same time, we need to make sure that our resources are properly, whatever we received from international partners is being used properly. For that, we know we need to use EIL principle, that is efficiency, impact, and localization. Now, whole system or Nepal country itself has gone to federal system, and there is a provincial government and local government as well. That's why we would like to strengthen local level our bodies, our sub chapters or chapters, so that they have capacity and then they monitor or they can deliver the services. Once local level capacity is strengthened, then services will be effective as well as efficient. Why I am saying this is that mostly in the remote part of country, when someone is trained as a Red Cross volunteer, he or she can deliver services promptly. So they are beneficiaries, but at the same time they are responder. And when we talk about largest humanitarian organization, it's built by the sub-chapter, district chapter, and its nationwide volunteers. So we really count on them, and our prime responsibility is to build their capacity, build roster and monitoring system, and refresher or having some sort of backup mechanism so that we can mobilize them effectively and efficiently.
Well, Mr. Arial, thank you very much for joining us. It was a pleasure talking to you.
It's really a pleasure, and it's a nice opportunity to talk and share views on Nepal Red Cross, and somehow it's a plan for upcoming days as well. Thank you.
Dear viewers, time now to wrap up the show. Keep watching us. See you next week. Namaste.